So my name is Christoph. I'm the author of the Boost Metastat Machine Library. Today I'm going to talk about a little bit about the Metastat Machine, but not so much, so don't run away. The biggest part will be the asynchronous tile part. And if you don't know the Metastat Machine Library, it's a library which kills your compiler in exchange for high speed and cool features. And if you know it, then you probably already have a good compiler, because you have no choice. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about the machine, a bit more about this asynchronous library which I'm writing. I plan to offer it to Boost later if it looks like you like it and you don't throw me with tomatoes before the end of the talk. We'll get to see this. So we start with a small story. Here comes exactly the correct one. The interesting story is an idea taken from Michael in 2010. He had a wonderful story with slashes, and I stole from him a little bit. You excuse me, Michael. Okay, then I'm going to try to explain you why you need state machines, and then we're going to go to the synchronous programming. So my story is not a slushy; it's a fast food restaurant. And here you see, you have a queue of burgers. You have just one machine of drinks, so you have no queue, and you have one worker waiting for customers. So far, so good. The first customer comes, he orders something, gets what he ordered, and goes. This is when all goes good. But the restaurant is working well, and more people are coming, and they are waiting. So the worker is staying, so he's taking up the first customer and is just waiting like this. The queue becomes long, customer complain, and the owner thinks, no problem, I'm going to hire a second employee. So, logically, if I have two workers, I'm going to handle twice more customers, right?
You also double the burgers?
Of course, yes, we have an endless supply of burgers. You know, we can just put burgers as much as we want. This is not a problem. We can put a big machine doing all this. The problem is the workers. The machine is working, don't worry. We have many workers behind which we don't see. And so we hope to be faster, but something unforeseen happens. Sometimes the employee fight to get the burgers to their customer first. If you think I'm constructing this example, you're dreaming. It really happened to me, because you know, sometimes I have to go with my kids to some unnamed fast food restaurant just because they have some cool toys which we absolutely must have. Right? You all know all this, right? Okay. And so then I'm looking, saying, it's not working. It's just not working. And I took the one guy who let everybody go in front of him. So first, this guy came and took my burger. Then the third guy came and took my burger. And the fourth guy took my burger. And the fifth one, I finally got my burger. I never went to this restaurant again. Really, it's terrible. So in the first case, they both fight for the burger, even though we have a queue. It can be even worse. Sometimes they get in each other's way. This one already started the drink and wants to get the fries. There's no burger anymore. Okay. And the other one has a fries and he wants a drink. And there's no place behind this desk. And they try to go in front of each other and it doesn't work good. And they block each other. And it takes seconds before they manage to go further. And there's just two. Now we want to add a third and a fourth. Oh my God. So what happens? First, the cost explodes because we have more and more people, more and more employees. Because of all the efficiency, the waiting times increased and they're even worse than before. The customers flee the restaurant in panic. The restaurant gets bankrupt. It's a very sad story, right? I mean, actually not so much because no fast foods, okay. But well, in theory, it's a very sad story, right? It's not as good as Michael's story, but still it's a very sad story. So can we avoid this? Yes, we're going to go asynchronous. We save money, have just one worker. We fire the second one. I know, it's really sad my story. So I have just one worker. And this worker is a special one. He can run really, really fast. In zero time, he goes from the drinks to the burgers, to the burger to the desk, from the desk to the second desk. He's so damn fast, this is the employee of the month. Of course, he's the only left one, but still. So he never waits, and he's not just fast, he's also very, very clever. He remembers in which state of the order, because the order is just some state machine. It remembers in which state of the order the customer is. For example, this one is thinking because it didn't order at all. This one's waiting, but maybe one already ordered, said, oh, I know which burger I want, but I need to think for the drink. So, okay, so it remembers which customer on which cash desk is doing what or waiting for what. It only reacts to events. The burger is ready, a customer shows something, whatever. Okay? It's good, huh? There's no problems with that he has to fight for a resource with someone. There's no deadlock. Look how fast he is. It's incredible. He's here. Is the customer ordered a Big Mac? Oh, I don't want to say which restaurant it was. Now I lost. Okay, I didn't want to make advertisement. I'm very sorry. So then he runs to the burger, and then the second one ordered a drink. So he goes on to the drink, and then he brings the burger to the first customer back and said, so here's your Big Mac. Do you want fries with that? And while the customer is thinking, he runs to the second cash and gives a drink. And all this in zero time. It's incredible. All this because our machine is working behind. Okay, but still, he's doing this in zero time. So this is what Pat want to tell you today. Now, why do we need state machines? As you saw, the state machines will help us realize which customer is in which state and what he's waiting for. But more seriously, they're helping us design. How often do I see code just hacked like this? I mean, you know how it is. You start a project. You want to make some spec, but then the big customer comes and you make the design, the update of the design a bit later. And then at the end, you have no design. So this will help us design. It will help us document, because at least there will be something left at the end. It will help us debug. You know, when you see, if you have good log files and you see bug report and you have monitor logs and you think, how come did I land in this state? I should never be in this state. So this is a good starting point. And as you will see, it will help us think asynchronously. So this is our pattern of the day, the chef of us today. A manager implemented a state machine, runs very fast, but in his own one thread. There's no second thread, there's no race, there's no deadlock, there's nothing, there's just he alone. He's never blocking, because if he blocks, he cannot turn anymore. So he never blocks, never, never, ever. And some target hardware threads, whatever you want, is controlled sequentially and lives either on another thread or in another machine, whatever you want. What do we need to achieve this? We need a state machine library. By pure luck, I know one. It's called the Meta State Machine. It's really great. You should try it. What we don't have, what I postulate we don't have, is an infrastructure to manage this asynchronous behavior. Not yet. So let's see what we have for infrastructure in C++ today. We have to thank the standard committee for this stuff. So what do we have? We have std async. We have a lambda inside. It's going to execute asynchronously, I hope. And we're going to get a future int because this stuff gives an int. So far, so good. Then we call get, we block, and wait for the result. Sounds good, huh? If only it was so good. So it's simple, but blocking is bad for state machines. If I have a state machine where I have to implement a run-to-completion algorithm, which means I have to go from state A to state B in zero time, like my worker, and I have to wait and block, it's bad. I cannot ask the state machine, which state are you? I cannot go handle any timeout, any errors, anything. I don't even talk because I'm blocked. So I have a state machine which is going to do nothing for you. It's bad. If I block, I have no diagnostic. I cannot say, oh, I'm working this, doing this is 5 minutes, because you know, I'm just blocked. I don't talk anymore. I'm pissed off, I don't want to talk. As you notice, it makes your program less responsive. Come on, we make stuff like this. And now try to explain me how in the Qt application we are going to use it. So we are back in the 90s, where you are pressing on the user interface and you waited. Please wait, please wait, please wait. Come on. Oh, I got something. So this is what we get today. Good luck to program your next user interface. And when we block, we don't think that maybe we could do something else, like start another task, do some work, start some calculation. So we are losing opportunities for concurrency, which is bad.
That's actually actually with the filter you can test whether it's still running.
So, yes, with the filter I can wait if it's still running. I'm going to go back to it.
Okay.
So, I said waiting is okay, blocking no. Bonus question, in which thread is Lambda executed? Nikolai?
Depends.
Ah, it depends. It depends of what?
In the same or in another.
Oh, it's great. this is asynchronous, right?
Not always, that's not the
idea.
It's good. It's good that we are talking about implementation if I'm not, because I took time to look in the C++ reference. And this is what you see.
And therefore you need a good book to understand
that. That's what I wanted to show. Look at the first one simple function. Oh, this is bad. Windows, go away. Oh, come on. So, okay, I give up. If the async flag is set, then it's in a separate thread. If it's the flag, then boom, 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 boom. Wait, it's getting better and better. It's up to the implementation. If it's an asynchronous or lazy evaluation, this is for the implementation part. This is undefined. And so sometimes you send this thread, sometimes it's another one, sometimes implementation defined. And honestly, I spent 10 minutes looking at it. After 10 minutes, I gave it up. So, okay, now it's enough. I don't want to look at this anymore.
The news is in GCC, it's currently not running in a background thread or in a separate thread.
Great. So.
That's how it is implemented. The algorithm to choose whether to start a new thread or not is not ready yet.
Oh, the algorithm to decide if where to start is not ready yet. It's bad. So it's a no problem because I'm going to offer you a ready solution right now. So what do we have for alternatives? We block while waiting, what I just showed. We poll, which is what we were suggesting, right? Which is so 90s. Come on, polling! I didn't do it since I was a student. And I felt ashamed when I was doing it, honestly. Or, second alternative, we carry a bag of features with us, we put all the features which we get from all the async call, put them in a big bag, and then, well, whether we do one of the above, which means either we do wait for all, or we poll all of them, right? This is so that. No, honestly, no, really not. I don't want to carry a bag of features, I don't want to poll, I don't want to block. So, which leaves me with no other solution to do something myself. Do you spot a problem here? It's getting better by the minute. Wait, this one is even when I saw this, I gave it up once for good. Where is F and where is G going to be? When? No, so let's say, when are they going to be executed?
When?
Not where, when?
Where?
When?
Okay, when the implementation feels like.
You think?
In some order.
Well, I have bad news for you. The second line will not run until F completes. Do you know why? Nikolai knows, but does someone else know?
Because you're not capturing a future, so it's at the end of the statement.
Yes, I don't capture at all. I don't save it at all. There is no future. It's destroyed. It's temporary.
So it has to wait until it actually...
Yeah, so it blocks until it is blocked at the destruction of the future. So what we did here is the longest possible synchronous program.
Yeah.
Unless you run it on a Windows.
Oh, God.
Because they don't follow the
cell at
here.
No, so even better.
Async could be a
So which means it's going to work at the moment, and when it will stop working, right?
No, the standard already in Windows says it should
be destroyed.
But Windows is wrong. Windows is simply wrong. Windows has a bug.
It's good. I love it. I just love it.
Yeah, but that's not how it is intended.
Okay, it's great. So, other people came with much better solutions, which I'm going to destroy immediately also as I'm at it. So here you have an async, and you get a first feature. And then we say, okay, we have a bad solution, but we're going to fix it a bit, let's get to work. So what do? We had a then, which means when we're going to make to register what is called a continuation, I think. And then means when this feature is ready, or is an exception probably, then please execute, no, please register this lambda with the next feature, which should be done when it's ready, right? Something like this. So, And then you think, oh, the get here is not going to block. It's true, it's not going to block. Is it great? Huh?
Getting is for other purposes than what you want.
Yes, and here we block. So, in the end, we will get to delay it, we get to make a get, then, and a then, and one another then, and then one more then, and when we get to have 10 pieces of them looking like a go to, we get to say, now we have a last feature, but what do we do with the last feature? Well, we can pull it, we can block, we can put it in our bag of one feature and carry it with us. It's much better, right? I tend to disagree with this. I'm very sorry, I just cannot accept this. Sorry, no.
Not for your purpose.
Yes.
I mean, that's clear.
Yes, it's not for my purpose. And there's another proposal. I won't say it now, but in detail. If I understand, it means we're not going to have futures. We're going to have async and await. So we're going to say this function is async, okay? And at the end, there will be await where we get to block, which is the same, except that we don't have a future to poll. There's just block a solution. Am I right? Okay.
I should say we have condition variables.
Okay, so what will happen?
A couple of things, I agree with that.
Yes, so what will happen? I tell you what will happen because I had someone I know who programs in C#, said, but how did you do it in C#? He said, oh, it's not a problem, I started a new thread. Wait, what do you mean? This one is blocking, so I just started a new thread. Okay, new thread means, first we have to start a thread. We have to manage the life cycle of a thread. We have to stop a thread correctly. And there are a few messages in the boost mailings telling you how damn hard it is to stop a thread. And then, as we have two threads, we are going to go on the same data, we're going to have mutexes. I'm very sorry, I had to say this terrible word. We're going to have mutexes. It's terrible, I know. Which means we're going to get deadlocks and race conditions, and it's going to continue. Before I go to this, it's true, Nicola is right, it's not for my case. So let's explain my case. I'm working for a company called Dr. Schenk. It's a German company. And we are producing inspection systems, optical inspection systems, for all what you want. Paper, glass, usually stuff like this. I will not tell you for which console we're going to work, but it will be almost all of them. So, they have some glasses on the line, and they're coming at very high speed, and we're going to do lots of image analysis on them. Some terribly quadratic algorithm. Something which, my God, it's going to work, it's going to explode. And once in a while, comes from the production a bad glass. It's broken, there's some corner missing, there is also a big piece of water on it. It's great for the optical channels, it's really wonderful. And then the algorithms are really going to explode from the standard 100 milliseconds to 30 seconds. So what's going to happen? If you're going to do this stuff, we're going to block. So we're going to block, let's say, 30 seconds, and they go every seconds. So we're going to not give an answer for this glass, for this one, for this one, for this one, for this one, etc., etc. In the next 5 minutes, the chef of the customer is going to know it. Then it's going to call all the way to the chef of my company. It will go all the way down to me, and then it's looking bad. So that's why I don't want to use this stuff. There will be another solution, of course. For those who know BoostASIO, you start an asynchronous operation, and you wait for a callback, which will be something like this, with an error code. It goes already much more direction which I would want. There's just a few problems with ASIO. First of all, you have problems with lifetime. If you make a not trivial application with ASIO, you will realize that the callbacks keep coming everywhere when you don't expect them. No, again. And then, of course, the object which gives the order is since long destroyed. And if you didn't think about checking it with three pointers or whatever you want, it's going to crash. And it crashed quite some time. It's the problem also of managing the asynchrony. Meaning you have just a way to post tasks, you don't have a way to stop them, you don't have the ways to check how long it took, it's very limited. I mean, for the asynchronous part, for the network part, it's absolutely wonderful.
Just for comment, you're right, you cannot measure the duration of the task, but you can cancel all of them or stop them.
Not if I, the comment is I can cancel the task. Can I cancel a post? there is an, in the IO service a post on which I can post a callable object. Can I stop it?
No, you can.
I cannot. Yes. And that is the one which I was wanting to use, because async write is good for network part, but for the asynchronous part, I've just post, which was say I cannot cancel. It's quite bad for me. I could cancel it with tricks, okay. But well, okay. Not out of the box. Oh, and there are some features missing. So what I would like would be something like this. I have made a function called post callback. I'm going to execute this long-lasting task in a thread pool somewhere. You will know where after. And when it's done, I get a callback with a feature containing the result. So here we have an int, and here we get an int. But the callback first is going to be not blocking, because the feature will be ready when we get it. It will have either a result or an exception. It's not blocking, and we want, as we're at it, that the callback does not come if the one calling this is gone. This is what I would like to have, right? Okay, maybe we can discuss if it's a feature of unexpected. Okay, we can discuss about this. But this would be the idea which, personally, I would like to have.
So make a proposal.
And you know what? I still have almost 1 hour, and you know what? You're going to get your proposal. I promise you, you're going to get it. So I'm going to make an example. I'm not allowed to show our code, so I'm going to construct a Qt application showing you a bit what problems we are facing. So we have a user interface where I took my standard CD player example, and I'm going to make it a bit bigger. So we have a CD player, and we want a simulation for it. I want to build it fast. So this is the only part where I really have some state machines. So I even brought spec. Imagine we have a spec. It's not very often that we have specs, right? So we have a spec. So we have the someone's going to use this stuff. It can open by pressing a button. It can close. And there's just one button for open and close, so the name must switch each time. And it can play the disk. And when it plays, you have to check if the disk is valid. We can navigate between songs, next song, previous song, and we can change the volume. We can stop or pause, and we don't want user to be able to press buttons which are not, we have no meaning in the state where we are, so we are going to deactivate the buttons which we don't need. And we want also default playing. As is very often, you have a CD player, you open it, you put CD inside, and you press play. Then you close, and it doesn't play, because it was the wrong state. You know, it's only when it's closed that it will play. So we want to defer the playing to that the state remembers that we want to play when we get to start playing. I wrote a very small design for this, if we can call it a design, because it's really limited. We have a player logic class, which is going to hide all the logic. And it will contain a state machine. Hidden, so because you know MSM state machines tend to be long to compile, so we want to hide them in your CPP file. And we have a small user interface, we're going to make the simulation. It's going to pretend that it's also a piece of hardware, because the hardware is not ready yet, like always. Software is ready and the hardware is not. Do you notice? I always have it. Oh, sorry. Sorry. And so it's going to also say, there's a display and then there's the hardware also. This is hardware. And it's going to have an SU IO service, which we're going to use just for the time events. So we need a timer, so we're going to use IO service just to have another thread. And this will be the state machine which we have. So we start normal state, in state, and we immediately with an unnamed transition, meaning we don't need an event to start moving. Who has already seen MSM? Okay. Who knows state machines? Okay, so a bit more. So, do we all know what is an unnamed transition? There are many names for this. It can be anonymous also. It means something without event, we go directly in this state. And we execute an action on the way to show the welcome message. So we're empty. We wait for someone to open and put a disk. So someone will need to press on the open button. And we'll be opening. Then there'll be our timer, which we'll say, because we have no other button to us, that it's open. After 2 seconds, it's open. Okay, then we go to the open state. And when the open state, someone's going to put a disk and press again the same open close button, but this time to close. And we go to the closing state. We're going to wait, it's closed, and we go back here. Right? When we are back in another state, we have a CD, inside. We don't know if it's good or not. The hardware is going to check it and send us some CD detected event if it's good. Yes.
I'm sorry, it goes back to the empty state after you've put the CD in?
Yes. The name is not fantastically chosen. You're right. So yes, the question is why do I name my state empty? Because I'm famous for picking always terrible names. So I'm very sorry for this. I'm famous for this.
Closed.
It should be closed. Yes. I'm very sorry about it. Same question. Okay. So now that the not empty is left, we're unstopped. And we wait for the user to press play. So when he plays, we move to the playing state. Oh, great. And then he can either press pause or press stop. If we stop, we go back to stopped. And pause, we go and paused. The difference being that when you're paused, you want to restart the same way you already were. So I'm missing what I promised you, the play. So here you have, you will have here, differ event play. So if I'm closing and someone press play, I will remember it and not to forget. If I press play too early, it's okay. I will remember it. So the event is differ, meaning waiting for the next state where you can try again. Then we move here and they will say, oh, can I handle play? No. Okay, I will keep it. No problem, I differ it again. Then this, we have CD detected when the disk is found. We move here. Can we handle play? Yes. Hop. We move to playing. We are done. We saved our events. It's great. We can do even more funny stuff, but I don't know if I draw it. No. Okay. So it's a very simple state machine. You can do it in 1, 1.5 hours, and then actually you're almost done. And you just need to type. This is a bad part. Yes, this account also. So this is a playing state. We are running. We have two regions, so two active states at once. And so we are running. And each time we have a next song, someone press next, 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 we go back to running. If it's not the last song, you have a guard here. This is a guard saying, if there's this event, call this, but only if this is true. So if it's not the last song, we stay where we are and we play next song, next song, next song. And if it's the last one, we want to exit and go back, exit, to stop. And the same for the previous song. My second reason is just to handle the volume. Each time someone press volume up, I'm going to change the text of the user interface and say a volume is now 25. And then we go back to, after 2 seconds or something like this, to the original text of the song. So we have a small state machine, right? Okay, we'll happily show you how it looks like. Oh, it's really small. My God. Okay. The resolution is really terrible. So it's not very easy to see. So this is a transition table of MSM. For every transition you have one row. It starts with a start state, and we move to the target state when the event comes. In the first, we saw we had unnamed transition, which means none, means it's okay, it's no event, you can just go. And by doing this, we're going to call this. And we have all our transitions like we wrote, written one by one here. So source, event, target, action, and the guards are shown a bit, we have no place, the guards are here. For example, if we have a good disk, we take this transition. And if we have not a good disk, then we do something else. Okay, so far so good. So we type all this until we have wrote all our state machine. All what is left to us is define the events, which are very simple. An event is simply a struct. That's it. And we define states, which are a struct inheriting from MSM state. So we type all this, and we are done. We still need our deferred event, right? Our play here, we have MPL vector with one event, it will be deferred. MSM will see this and say, oh, OK. It's deferred. Okay, I will keep it. Okay. It just leaves us with the stuff which I promised you about the buttons. Well, every state knows. In my state, for example, if I'm playing, it makes no sense to use a play button. So every state, for example, let's say this is closing, is going to offer flags. And flags means it's a property which is true when the state is active. In this case, when we are closing, we allow play. That's why when we put the disk and we close, if someone press play, we'll allow it because he could do it because we allowed it. And as we allowed it, he can press play, which means that we're going to defer, and which means that we're going to keep it for later. It gives us something like this. Not that you waited for nothing. You have to see that I really mean that it can even work. I mean, if it still compiles. So we have our CD player. I press an open. It's opening. One, two. It's open. I've just put a timer for this. We have no hardware because we know we save on the hardware. It costs too much time. We have to 2 seconds. It's simply open. So then we can close, either with close or with play. Let's say we close. We are closing, and then we press play to keep it. So now we know we have it. Now we are changing the disk. So this user interface, as we saw at the beginning, also simulates the hardware, because the hardware is not ready, of course. So this is the part which simulates the hardware. So we say we have a good disk, and the CD is detected. Hop, and we already start playing the song, because we cued play. And so we start playing Let It Be. Well, and then we can go to the next. We have seen the second song of Beatles, and then the third one, well, I put just three. And then it's the last song, so if I press next, we're going to exit and go back to stopped. And we go back to stopped. And we can play again. Okay? There are a few more tricks, but I will not have time to show all of them. Yes, Michael?
Can you explain your flag list?
The flag list, yes. Can I play the flag list? So, a flag list is something which is true when a given state is active state. So if my state machine is a state closing and I ask, is this flag true? I will get true. And for all the other flags will be false. Now I just need to say, for my buttons, for example, for the play button, when the user interface is going to ask, is play possible? Where is my play possible? Is play possible? State machine, is the flag play possible active? If true, the button is activated. That's it. It's just a simple tag. It's a tag. Flag is a bad name. Let's say it's a tag. And so in with everything, including all the test stuff, we have 500 lines, which is not bad. OK, so far so good. So I didn't want to put you too much state machines. I just wanted to show you on this. When you have something complex, a user interface, or some complicated algorithm, you will need a state machine, and then you will see, yes, but then my frustrator, I just have STD ASIC. Oh, it's bad. For simple stuff, STD ASIC is great, yes. If you make some wonderful example how you can calculate parallel Fibonacci, it's great. But if you want to do something more real, which real people will pay for, well, you will think that a state machine on one side, in a thread, like a cute thread, doing all the work, I mean, controlling everything, and using someone else to do the work, it will be great. So I wanted just to sell you the idea of using state machine for this. I know this is bad. Where's my talk? Here. Okay, so let's talk about patterns. What patterns do we have to handle all this? So we want an object running in this one thread, running and controlling everything and giving orders. We have what is called an active object. It's known in the OO world, but in C++ world it's seen as, oh my god, it's so bad, no, we don't want to know it. I'm going to explain you why. So we have an object, servant. It's not thread safe. It's not thread safe at all. If someone attacks it with 2 threads, it's dead. And it runs in a scheduler, which means a thread. And when someone wants to call some methods from him, like F1 or F2, it cannot go directly. It has to go through a proxy, something which pretends that it's a servant, but it's not. When you call something on this proxy, I will get a future. So the difference for the client is suddenly it gets a future. The proxy will enqueue a job in the activation queue. The scheduler will take the job and execute it. And what is the job? It will be something, a bind or some lambda to F1 or F2. And that's it. So by serializing the calls, we make an object, it's not thread safe, object thread safe. It just has a few problems. So it's thread safe now. The outside node will only see a proxy, so a small change, you will not get an int directly, but a future int. And you can block on it. A scheduler will take its job. They are executing the scheduler context with thread safe. But the problem is, they are expensive. If you have to pay one thread for every object, it's going to be, you're going to need quite some resources. So we don't want to have this. And that thing is helping us parallelize. So we need something else. We have the proactor. It's what SU is doing. I will not go into big details. An initiator posts and creates an asynchronous operation, which an asynchronous operation process will execute. Right? Yes. Then we'll get in the queue a completion event queue. Oh my God, it's hard. With the deplacer will dequeue, and at the end we'll get a completion ender for the which the initiator can get back. So I'm sorry, it's a bit complicated to explain in 2 minutes. So let's say you post some task, and when it's completed, you get a callback.
You might have to hold resources for the job to complete as well.
Yes. Oh, please, the question. Do I have to keep resources for the time of the job?
There
might be some state. It's anyway, until the job completes, I will have to keep some resources, of course. Yes. Yes. So this is some very popular pattern, incredibly popular pattern. It's called a thread safe interface. If I count the number of companies who try to sell me that one, poof, I will probably not have fingers on one hand. So I have a structure called unsafe. So its name already tells you everything. So we have a method foo, remember foo. It's locking, it calls some private method, and unlocking. Meaning, the public ones lock, and the private ones consider they are already locked when they execute, and they don't lock anything. And we have a mutex. So it is the last one you're going to see one today. So enjoy it good. And is it safe?
Depends on who
you are. Mm?
You should use a lock guard.
Sorry?
You should use a lock guard that the mutex is also unlocked.
Should I?
It depends on what foobar does, doesn't it?
Yes. Yeah. What most people are doing, that's why I let it this way, is the. I'll come back to you. The question was, should I scope lock? I could scope lock, but then most people will see after a while it's a bit slow, so they will unlock, do something else, which they think is thread safe, and then lock again. That's why they're not going to use scope, or they're going to use partly a scope until they release it again. And this was the best rest conditions come. Lock, unlock, I will do something, it's safe, lock again. But luck, it was not safe. You will see, lock, foobar, unlock, do something unlocked, and then lock again, lock. This is what you're going to see very often.
This code is always a bad idea. You should always use scoped locks. You should, if you need to unlock it in the scoped lock, use another Ray wrapper that does a scoped unlock. And then you should always pass the scoped lock to the methods that expect to be locked, because they need to be able to assert or throw an exception
if
they're not locked.
So the point is, truly, that I should not do something like this. I should guard and give the lock to the next function. Yes, but you know what? People are not doing this.
Yes.
It's crazy, but they are still doing something like this. So this will be the first problem. Do we see more problems? This was the obvious one. Yes, okay, come on. We can do better than this.
The lock could be in an undefined state.
The lock could be in an undefined state. Yes, maybe, probably, yes. Yes. Something else? More fun? Foobar could call outside some public method. He said, yes, I didn't see that was public, because when you type, you don't see it's public, and hop, and you deadlock yourself. What is the solution? What I normally see is, come on, recursive locks, of course. When you see this, you know it's dead. And it's really dead. It's dead. So this will be the second problem. A third one. Yes?
Safe from the corner, then you might need a lock if you know the object is unset, but not try to lock within the object.
There's a monitor.
I should not lock within the object. I should lock outside of the object. Yes. Yes, I should do this. But this stuff says, the philosophy behind this is, a class, and I heard it hundreds of times, the class has to protect itself against race conditions. And I postulate a class cannot protect itself against race conditions. It has to be protected by someone else. And why? Okay, let's say I did all correctly. Lock, unlock, FUBA is okay, I don't call it back. Am I safe now? Am I finally safe? If I call outside the class, what should I call outside the class? Yeah, you want to something, it's good. Okay, so someone who calls from outside and calls this. You're locked, you're safe. Or, maybe not. There's a time when you're not safe.
When you execute something async and give it a handler, and then the function ends and it's unlocked and the handler is executed when it's unsafe.
When you have a handler which is executed. At object destruction, you have a race condition. Because when the destructor will come, you get to destroy the mutex, of course, and if someone is still waiting for the lock here, oops. So, nobody thinks about the destructor, right? But it's hard. It hurts. So, this would kill us, the stress-safe interface pattern, right? So, now all the everybody in this room agrees we will never do something like this. It's great. At least a few bugs which I will not have to fix anymore. Okay, so Nicolas said I should make a proposal. Let's go to the proposal. It's a new library. It's Boost. It's called Boost. It's a Boost namespace. It's not Boost yet because I just saw it here for the first time. So I will see how it goes. I need a review manager which I didn't look for one yet because I showed it for the first time. It's C++ 11 only. We're going to have lots of fun in the reviews. I see the comments here. But it's not compatible to 0.3. No. No, it's not. If I have the choice between spending 3-4 weeks to make this stuff 0.3 compatible, it's 4 weeks which I will not use packing features. You know what? I prefer pack features. I think in 2014, it's time to accept that we have 2011 standard. So, no, it will not be 0.3. No way. So, you can already prepare your comments for the review. There will be no 0.3. It compiles just with the two only C++ compilers we have, which is GCC more than 4.7, at least 4.7, and Clang 3.4, even so I think 3.3 works. It will not compile with Visual Studio, at least at time I tried, because, well, it implements almost nothing. So.
I'll be your review manager.
You'll be a review manager. Great, I found my review manager. I didn't come for nothing today. Oh, can you sign already? But you didn't see the library yet. Wait a bit. It's too early, Michael. Wait 45 more minutes, okay? It said only, because I've just said only. And however, I use some stuff which are not said only. Boost thread, chrono, dead time, and serialization sometimes for some features. I will come to this point later. So the question was, why Boost Thread, not STD Thread? Because there is one feature in Boost Thread which absolutely need and the standard didn't want to give me.
Terminate?
Not terminate, but you're not far. Yes. Yes. Well, I will consider moving to STD Thread when STD Thread offers me interruption points. Until then, I will stick to Boost.
Do you know why they didn't put it in the standard?
No, but maybe, I don't know why they don't put it in the standard, but maybe Nicola can tell us. I have no idea.
I'm not actively joining the concurrency working group. I only also ask questions. The reason will be probably, as far as I know them, that there are danger of some subtle bugs. So
some subtle bugs.
We are currently working there on a signal handling rules, so some interrupt rules against threads, etc. That's coming right now with C++ 17.
Okay, so it could come with C++ 17, and right now we're afraid of subtle bugs, which I think is okay because Boost is allowed to try stuff, but STD has to be careful. It's okay, I can understand this argument.
Yeah, but you are welcome to join the meeting.
You know, I already have so many free activities, slowly I have no more time for this. But I already make you a proposal. Look, Michael?
Howard writes a lot about this.
Sorry?
Howard writes about this a lot in his blogs because he's the one who doesn't like to have interruption points. And there seems to be consensus that it's easy to do and there's ways to do it, and or you shouldn't do it. And I think, personally, I think the boost rate is correct and it's uniform.
Yes.
I want everybody in the world to bring up their own way to do it.
So, Mike, I think the boost solution is correct. I also looked at it. I found no mistake, but it doesn't mean there is no. So, I understand that we want to be careful. It's okay. I can wait until 17.
Yeah, I just want to comment. It's super easy. It's not like super easy, but it's not like that hard to do if you've got the implementation.
It's easy to do wrong.
Okay, so we all agree it's easy to do right, it's easy to do wrong, and it will come until 2017. So can we move on now?
I didn't promise.
Okay, it might come in 2017. Okay. So, did I skip already? Oh, yes. Okay. So, the principle of asynchronous. You have to think in tasks, not threads. Forget threads. There is no thread. There is no thread. The thread, we change the definition of thread from boost or STD thread to some processing unit or context, whatever you want. But there is no thread. There is no STD thread. There is no boost. We don't see them. Believe me, it's so hard to start this stuff and to stop them correctly. You don't want to see them. It does all what it can to help you prevent raids, seize deadlocks, and crashes. If you follow a few principles, you will have none of all this. I mean, crashes, maybe other crashes, but not because of rest conditions and deadlocks and live issues. It executes tasks asynchronously, and all the results come as callbacks. And there's no blocking. Fast, in case I didn't say it yet, no blocking. It doesn't block. We don't block. We do not block. The only one who blocks is the main. The main starts everything and blocks until all is finished. Okay, the only one who can block.
You wait until all is finished?
You wait? Passively, you just sit like this and do nothing and wait?
No, I mean, we can do that.
Mm-hmm. It's okay. You might have the answer a bit later. So, let's use a few definitions because there will say lots of us which we don't understand. A scheduler is an object having some threads or not, can have zero sometimes. It executes jobs or callbacks, and when it's finished, when it's no more use, it stops the thread. So you have to do it, it will be stopped. Okay? We have what you call a weak scheduler, which is a weak pointer to a scheduler, so you don't keep the scheduler alive too long if you don't need. We have a servant. A servant is an object living in the single thread scheduler. It's our state machine. It starts task, wait for callbacks, reacts, do something else, and continues. We have a queue. A queue is where you put jobs for a scheduler to execute, like we saw the active object. We have a servant proxy. It's like the proxy which we had before. Means it's a thread safe object. It's only thread safe. It's copyable. It's thread safe. It's everything you want. It looks like a servant. It feels like a servant, but it's not a servant. It sails as a course to it, keeps the servant alive, and make sure to destroy the servant when you don't need it anymore. What was called a scheduler shell proxy? It's an object holding a scheduler and interfacing with it. So, what it means? We have a scheduler which will stop the thread, but the scheduler is living in the thread world, so it cannot join. The scheduler shell proxy will live outside, and the last one of them will join. I will come to the diagram to show you a bit more of it. Stealing, we always about stealing. What is stealing? It's a thread stealing a job from another thread, or a scheduler stealing from another scheduler. And I use often the word posting. It means simply enqueuing a job into a scheduler queue and waiting for it to happen. Okay, we have the definitions right? No? Yes.
Can you define thread?
Can I define what?
Define thread.
Thread? There's no thread. Oh, this!
Yeah.
I told you we undefined it from STD or boost thread to some processing unit. Some logical processing unit or some context.
So, thread, logical processing
unit. Yes. Okay. It's not STD thread. I mean, you don't know what is behind. You don't want to know. I mean, now you know it's a boost thread, but otherwise you don't want to know. Question?
So it may or may not run in a separate thread.
This one, it may or may not have threads. You can construct a scheduler with no thread, from which other threads will just steal.
Okay. So it's not a replacement for task.
No, it's not a replacement for task. A scheduler is not a task. Yes,
a scheduler and task. Zero or more threads.
Yes, a scheduler run task and might have zero to n threads. Exactly.
Would those be known as fibers and then elsewhere?
Sorry?
Fibers.
Would those be not a fiber. It's actually it's really a logical thread.
Right. I mean, which executes within a task?
No, it's a thread which waits for a queue, takes the job, executes it, and calls the callback. That's all it's doing, actually. It's very simple. We don't need to imagine something very complicated. It's so simple.
It's a worker.
Okay. Yes.
Perfect.
What differentiates a scheduler from an executor in the C++11 proposal or 14?
I have no idea.
Okay.
What is the difference between a scheduler and executor? I have no idea. From what I understand, an executor is not really something which executes stuff. It's just some indication of how it has to be scheduled, right?
Yes.
But
it seems to fit well.
Yes, but it's not. It's not some indication of what it has to run. It's really when you have it, you have your scheduler, you have it in the hand, it executes threads, and when you drop it, it stops and there's no thread. It's not an indication. It's really the pool itself. You have your workers in your hand. And you can drop them. The lifetime. So in asynchronous world, the biggest problem is someone gives an asynchronous order, and when the callback comes, the one who gave the order is gone, and you crash. So we can create any number of servants within a single thread context. Okay, so it's not like an active object, it's like an active world, or we have lots of objects living inside in this one thread. So it's just living there, waiting happily that something happens to so it can react. The servants are only visible to the mean, bad, outside world full of mean STD or boost threads waiting to attack it. So it's not, they're not visible just with the proxies. We don't trust the outside world because we think it's mean. So the last servant, or the last something which needs a scheduler, stops it. And the last proxy joins, which is because it's outside, it can do it. We have thread pool for posting, long-time job, and for parallelizing. And in case I didn't say it yet, we never, never, ever block. Not we. Outside you can block, not we. So let's see how it happens. Here we have a single thread world running the scheduler. Here is our weak scheduler. Here, do you manage to see? Okay, I will explain. My diagram is a bit too big. Okay, here we have servants, one and two. Here we have an any shared scheduler, so it's a scheduler. And here we have our weak scheduler. So the servants only have the weak scheduler, so they don't, by default, keep the scheduler alive. So all these four ones are living in our single thread world. When they need something, they use a thread pool. Here's thread pool. And where you get to see some schedulers. Okay, we don't care which ones yet. Outside, we have seven proxies. We have a 7-2 proxy pretending to be a 7-2, and a 7-1 proxy pretending to be a 7-1. Okay? The mean client full of mean threats who want to attack us is there. And this 7 proxy hold a scheduler proxy alive, which means now when we want to destruct, the client destroys this one. This one is destroyed. But this one is still alive because one is holding him. This one is holding him alive. Okay. Then the client destroys this one. This one is destroyed. Then it goes. And then both were holding the scheduler proxy alive. Now nobody's alive. It destroys. When it destroys, it kills this one. This one stops. And this one joins until waiting this one to be destroyed. And that's it. You destroy, it goes. It's like we imagine to hold the shared pointer. When we don't need it, it's gone, and the threads are gone also. And that's it. We are far from STDSing now. Huh? Okay, so far so good? Why do we do all this? Because I learned the hard way, the problem for an object is not living. It's dying correctly. It's so hard to die. It's so damn hard to die. You always have something you forget to destroy. You have some signals to go everywhere. All this stuff. Like this, you shut down correctly. and you control everything. So the features. We talked about the lifetime control and the proxies. We have more. We can interrupt. We can get some diagnostic what the system is doing. We have some form of continuations, which are hiding some features. And we have some ways to distribute across machines. And we have some parallel algorithms also. As we had it, we offer some wrapper to play nice with Qt. So if you can say, I have a Qt servant which has a thread pool, and the jobs will be posted back to the Qt thread as always, as if it was a normal servant which you write yourself. And we have some queues, some thread pools, and stuff like this. It's not many, but you can contribute. It would be nice. So let's make a simple one, the most simple example, which is the stuff which you will see today and never want to use. So here we create a scheduler. It's a thread pool scheduler, the standard one. Really the simplest one with one queue. And it has a log-free queue, which is actually a wrapper around the boost log-free queue. Yes, already first question was fast.
Why is that a shared feature instead of a unique feature?
Where are you?
No. Here? Yeah.
Because I've run the example like this. It can be a future, but I'm not there yet. Wait, I'm here. So the question is, what is the shared future? It's a shared future because because my example was like this. It doesn't have to be, of course. So here we have a scheduler proxy. It has a thread pool with three threads. And you say which thread pool you want to use and which queue. So you have control everything. I block nothing. If you want a new queue, you can write your own queue. If you want a new scheduler, you can have your own scheduler, and that's it. And if it plays well, you can use it. Then we use the post with future, and we get a future or a shared future. Okay, it can be a future. And as it was an int, we get an int. And we can get like std async. Okay, it's almost the same as before, with only one difference isn't here. You give a scheduler, and you keep it alive. When you want to drop it, you drop it, and it's done. But before it goes, it will execute the task which you give it. It will not go just like this. It will wait that you finish. It will empty the whole queue, execute everything, and then go. So let's write a servant. I think much simpler is not possible. We have a servant, a bit stupid one. It's just an constructor which takes an int, and there's two simple methods. Remember, do it with no argument, and a foobar with two arguments. Okay, it's a plain boring class. There's nothing special, right? And we want this stuff to live in our thread, and we want to offer these two methods, these two members, outside for others to use. We create a proxy which inherits from asynchronous servant proxy, saying which servant it is. We have a forwarding constructor, so it's viadic, this is why it needs C++11 for all this stuff. You can have as many arguments as you want, they'll be forwarded to the servant. And we have two members which we give outside. 30 minutes later, oh my god. Okay, foobar and do it. This one we say we post so it will return nothing. And this one we return the future. So now I have to correct you to exaggerate, my god. Okay, let's use it. We have a scheduler. It's a single thread scheduler because our servant is not thread safe. We use a log-free queue because it's the fastest one. And at the end of the block, it's joined. So, but let's start. First, we need our servant proxy. We give it some int because we wanted some int. It gets, and then this means that a servant will be created in this thread with this argument. Then we can use the proxy as if it was a servant. Foobar gives nothing. Foobar gives nothing. We can call it. And do it gives a future, so we have a future. It can also be a future, not a shared future. Sorry, my examples were made at the time where I found shared future really cool. I changed my mind.
Can you go two slides back? No, three slides back, so one more. No?
This one, maybe?
Mm-hmm. One more?
This one?
Ah, okay. So now, okay. Yeah.
Okay. So this one is posted and gives nothing. This one gives a future. It's do it. Do it gives a future. It's an int, so we give a future int. Okay, so the outside world can use it like it wants. Mostly, I start a main. Main creates the first proxy, which just a single function run, which gives a future void, or which the main is going to block, and then everything else happens away from main. Here we finish the block, which means the seventh destructor is posted to the thread pool, to the single thread scheduler, so it can execute in the correct thread. And here the scheduler is gone, so we executed the destructor, we stopped the scheduler, and we joined it. We are done. Yes.
Sorry, but you said, so once the scheduler is destroyed, if the proxies haven't finished running, they still
run.
All right, but you have the notion of cancel?
Not yet.
Okay.
I didn't cancel yet. Here, I didn't cancel anything. Even so, I don't advise you to cancel a destructor.
No.
I don't think it's something you want to do.
No, of course not.
Of course. Yes, yes, yes. You could cancel later. I will get to come to cancel later, if I have time. Okay, a thread pool. Let's use the thread pool now. So now we change our seventh to be a bit cooler one, not to really do some work, and we make it a trackable seventh, which means the library will take care that this stuff is alive when you need it. So it gets a scheduler, it's a weak scheduler, you don't care, you just pass the buck to the constructor of the trackable seventh. So this seventh needs a thread pool to do the work. It creates a thread pool scheduler with a queue and three threads. So we have a seventh, it has a thread pool, it could share it with others, but now it's keeping it alone, and is ready. Okay, we have a thread pool with three threads, and now we are ready to start. Let's start. The seventh, in any member it wants, when you do it or whatever, wants to call post callback. This is our long task which we post. Okay, it's not very long, but okay, it's a simple one. And when this stuff executed, this lambda will be posted back to the scheduler of the seventh and executed with a future int which is ready as either a value or an exception. So this stuff is not called until this stuff is finished. So this will execute the thread pool, and this stuff here will execute in the single thread scheduler where the seventh lives.
Does post callback block? No.
No. No, no.
So we pass this to the call servant, and
we are allowed.
This might be not available anymore?
Yes, I could do it. So we're allowed. So if this is a question, if it's available. First of all, you mentioned this. It's a good point. We are not allowed to write this here. I mean, I don't advise you, because it means you are using your seventh in the thread pool. You are asking for rest conditions. But in the callback, as it's executed in your thread, you're allowed to use this. So this was part of this. If you see this here, it's looking bad for you. If you see this here, it's good. If you follow these tips, you will have almost never a problem. So now, about the execution. Yes. Yes.
Where is it blocking? So where
it's not blocking. Never.
But where do we ensure that this is still alive? That
when I explain you this. We have a trackable seventh, right? So we track if the seventh is alive, and we call this stuff only if the seventh is alive. So it's not a safety, it's optimization. If the seventh is no more here, the task which is posted doesn't interest anybody anymore. Don't execute it. If it already started to executing, okay, bad luck, it executes. The callback is called, so it's posted back to the thread of the seventh, and will be called only if the seventh is still alive, because we track the seventh.
So there's no race condition?
Of course not. If I have a race condition, you're allowed to throw me out of here, or throw me some tomatoes and say, okay, we can leave the talk, it's just a stupid talk anyway. It's the only race condition you can have if you write something like here. So here in the capture is the most dangerous part of all. If you write this, pointer to some to your attribute, a reference to your attribute, a shared pointer to yourself. Ooh.
What about globals? What if you have a side effect?
Globals.
Yeah, no, just in case.
I don't manage to hear correctly. Globals. If you have globals, yes, you'll be punished and you will deserve it. And you know what? I will not be sad 1 second for you.
But side effects.
Yes.
So
then you're dead. Yes, if you have globals, it's really looking bad for you. But you should not use globals, right?
What if I call rand, which has a side effect, which changes my random number generator?
You can have anyway without stress. If you have random.
I could know if it gets called, but if it never got called, it changes the deterministic state. It decides not to get called.
If you had several threads, we would have the same problem. But okay, yes. Okay, no problem.
You cannot know if you do not have a global variable hidden behind a system code or anything?
Yes.
That's my grand.
Okay,
question.
What I mean is global variables are clearly outside of the scope of this library.
Yeah.
It's not something I want to handle. I could somehow handle it, but I don't see the point in doing it. I mean, I'd have no control on them. I could make a global active object if I wanted, but it would be a bit strange.
So it's with regards to the globals thing, let's say that you have the global like inside of RAND, then if it's thread safe, it means that somewhere inside of that call to RAND, there's some mutex that's locking, which is going to completely mess up everything you're trying to do here. So the short answer is that anything that's got a global entity is going to have a side effect. Anything that would, you know, it's either not thread safe in the first place, or it's,
yes,
you know, going to be calling some OS-level mutex, which you shouldn't be doing inside the
yes
library.
So what Brice is saying,
it's a bug if you're
the comment was either it was thread safe, and then you had a mutex, which I don't want to know, or it was not thread safe, and then anyway you had a rest condition. Oh, I have not much time. Okay, so the future is not blocking, and we get either an exception or a value in the future. And this in the callback is safe. Okay? And we have our safety here, callback only if 70 is here, and task only if the 70 is still here. It's not the safety, it's just optimization. Okay, interrupting. Why would I want to interrupt? I have my glasses, you know, and one group explodes. Whoo, I have to stop it somehow. So, exploding algorithms. Or simply the system is droning. It's not just one algorithm explodes, it's just you have not enough cores. You have more and more work, more and more, and you don't manage to do all. Then you need to stop something to try to catch yourself back. Or you don't need the result anymore. It's too late, you know, you have some real-time stuff, and if you missed it, it's lost. Okay. But it requires support from the task. This way. So we change our post callback to an interruptible post callback. And we get an any interruptible. I'm a big fan of type erasure, so you're going to find many boost type erasure. So you have a task, and this type is a special one. It's something which understands interruption points because it's doing sleep. So it's one of the predefined boost red interruption points. It can be interruption point, sleep, lock, or all the stuff you don't need. Mostly to be sleep or interruption point. So the thread, the task has to play with us. The task has to say, we'll check sometimes if I have to be interrupted. If the task doesn't play, it's lost. There is no way to do it. I mean, no portable, correct way to do it. So these are boosts of our callback. Probably it will not be called because this stuff is not blocking and immediately after we interrupt. So it's not sure, but there's a very good chance that this stuff will be interrupted and that this stuff will never be called. Because this is executed just after this one. Okay?
So the task that you want to interrupt has to come and sleep for a little while?
No.
No?
It doesn't have to sleep. It has to call one of the, the question is, if the task has to sleep, the task doesn't have to sleep. In my example, it's easier to make sleep. It has to call one of the predefined interruption point. There are many of them, and one of them is boost this red interruption point. If it calls this from time to time, then it will happen.
To the boost thread.
Yes. I'm misusing boost thread for this. It was not meant for this, but okay. Okay? Yes?
If I understand correctly, you can, for example, call boost this thread interruption point, but you have to be cooperative with it.
Yes.
Imagine you are within a very tight loop.
Yes.
If you put a boost interruption point within your loop, you are killing your
path. If you do it every loop, it's bad. If you do it once every, I don't know what, 100,000 loops or something like this, you will guarantee that one day you will catch it back.
Yeah, but you're killing optimization opportunities.
Yes.
Okay.
Unfortunately, in this case, if you want to stop, you have to pay something. Yes, I'm killing some opportunities, yes.
Yeah, and of course also, if you use a third-party API, that also takes time, but use an API call to the OS or anything.
Yes, if I, whatever I it, they don't always, it's clear that the point is that the optimizations are not always doable. Yes, they are not always there because you don't know what you're doing. It all depends on the task. You don't want to interrupt every small task. You want to do the ones who are really have a big risk to explode. Okay, logging. This is very important. We are leaving from this. It helps you find the bottlenecks. It helps you find inefficiency in task. And how? You're going to post a task. It's going to tell you how long, when it was posted, when it was started, when it was finished, and if it was interrupted. If you make a statistic, you will know exactly which tasks are long, because we developers are known to be very bad at guessing which code a part of code is slow. So you will see really what's too long, if maybe your algorithm is inefficient, or if you should parallelize it, because really it's taking too long. Interestingly, it works on every scheduler, which means you can also call on your single thread scheduler and ask if the stuff the guy who is supposed to run very fast is maybe not running that fast as you think. And maybe you should not do this so much work, you should just post it away and wait for a callback. So you can really diagnostic all your system. You will know everything. If you have this, if you know how long a callback takes, how long a task takes, you make a full history on it, and you have a state machine telling you when the state was entered and left, so you will know exactly what happens in your system. And you'll have big surprises. So, but this was supposed to be fast. How come it lasted 25 seconds once? It was just once, it happened. So you can find also some concurrency opportunities, because you, you have a state machine which will tell you, this task is long. When can I start it earliest? And you state machine, you look, and hey, I could start it 3 states earlier. Let's start it 3 states earlier. This will know with all this. Okay. So an example. We have an any loggable, again any, and we choose a resolution. We take a boost chrono high resolution clock, for example. Okay, this is our servant job. Now we don't have a callable job, we have a loggable job. Which means our servant scheduler and proxy have to know that it's a different job which are handling now. That's why now we use these two templates arguments which we had. One for the scheduler, one for the thread pool. And it's changed almost nothing. We have our task, we have a callback, and we had a name. This will be the name of the task for the task and the callback. You have also for the macro, a log macro, in case you want the stuff, log the stuff which comes from outside. So here you get to find an item with name foo, one item with name int async work, and you get to know when they were posted, when they were started, because maybe they waited very long because the pool was full, when they were finished, and if they have been interrupted. If you have beautiful statistics, you know everything. Okay? So, it's almost the same, just we have just extra argument here. And different jobs. So, we can interrupt, we can log. Can we do more? Okay. We have a small range of schedulers. So, Sentinel is just a thread pool scheduler. We have a thread, also, we saw the single thread scheduler made for active objects, so for the servants. We have an Azure scheduler. Actually, it's I stole the Azure library. It's one thread running, we already include one IO service and running the loop of the IO service. It's pretty cool if you want to make some TCP communication. You already have a scheduler, and you can already make your async read on it, and it's already all there. It's pretty cool. We saw a thread pool scheduler. It can have one queue only, so we have concurrence in the queue, and zero and to n threads. And we have multi-queue scheduler. So for every thread, we have one queue to reduce the concurrency on the queue, to reduce the conflicts on the queue. It's, of course, faster. Disadvantage, it has to be at least one. You cannot have zero like in the thread pool. By default, you should use this one. So for the last two, so these two ones, we have a stealing thread pool scheduler and a stealing multi-queue thread pool scheduler. They're the same, but they don't steal from the threads of their own pool, but from other pools, if they know it. And how do you know it? In case, so let's see, we create one multi-queue scheduler. This one is not stealing, but it can be stolen from. We have a stealing scheduler with three threads. This one steals and can be stolen from. And now we create a composite scheduler when we bind as many pools as we want. And now we created one big pool with several pools. The first one is doing its job and refuses to be stolen jobs from. The second one is trying to steal. So in this case, nobody will steal, of course, but you could make 2-3 stealing schedulers. So why would you need this? You need this if you have priorities. You have one pool, which is your main pool, which has really to do much work. And you want a second pool, you don't want it to have no priority at all. You want it to try to do a bit of job when it can. But when he has no job, he has to steal from the upper one. And the upper one, if really it has a high priority, has more threads or whatever, but if he has time free, his threads are doing nothing, he will try to steal from the other schedulers. It's the priority. So you have scheduler priority now, and two different kinds of stealing inside a scheduler and from scheduler to scheduler. And you guarantee, for example, like this, that the lower priority pool will at least make some progress on this on these tasks. 15 minutes. Oh God. Okay. So this is the priorities. We showed the scheduler priority, but also queue priority. For example, so there's always a big discussion how to get a queue priority efficient. I think you cannot, so I said to give it up. I decided to make a special container, special queue, which is a queue of queues, I mean a list of queues. So here I put two queues inside. These are the arguments which I just forward, just ignore it. So we have a thread safe leaf queue and a log free queue. And this we give to our single thread scheduler. So now we have an active object which is going to take first jobs of the first queue and then for the next queue if it has time. Now we have also priority for our single thread stuff. Or any scheduler, of course. Because this is something you should always want. You have an active object which gets lots of job and doesn't manage to do everything. So you want the high priority jobs to be done and the other ones, if you can. Default priority is zero, meaning whatever, put it wherever, whichever queue you want, I don't care. So now we have our post callback, our task, our callback. This is the name, we don't give any name. So this is the priority of the thread pool, and this is the priority in the callback. So in this case, we don't care the priority of the callback, and we want it to go to the first pool of the servant. It's just choosing which scheduler you want to give the task. First one, second one, third one, in the order which you define them in the composite. Okay? So I'll do a bit fast because my time is going being short. So as I said, you can interact with queued. You decide that you have normal queue object, and you decide that you also want to be an asynchronous queued servant. If you do this, you can use post callback as always. Of course, the queue scheduler cannot have everything, so it doesn't have a priority because it doesn't have a queue which I control. You have no log, you have no interrupt. But otherwise, what is at the thread pool side, you have everything. Okay? It's practical for user interface. I have an example in the user interface how to use it. So, the next big part will be the continuations. So, normally I would tell you use callbacks. But there are some cases where even I have to accept, yes, callbacks are not the best way. If you have a Fibonacci task, where you get to create one task, we should create two more tasks. You have so many tasks that the callbacks are going to kill you. For this, you want continuations. It's something with future, so you want to be careful when you use it. The advantage is easy to use. And you can use it with any other future. For example, if you get a future from std async, you could pack it as a continuation and get a callback when it's done. So you can work around std async if you want it. Jens? Oh, I thought you wanted something. Okay. So it becomes very fast, very messy, because in principle, it's not very different from the then. So you want to be careful with it. So let's give an example. How do we make a parallel Fibonacci? Okay, we have a FIB task. It's a continuation task which we give along. So it's information for me to know what you want to do. So we get from this a task result, which will set this task is done. And we keep it. Now we decide if the Fibonacci number is smaller than the cutoff, we don't want to parallelize because it will be too expensive. This one we do it ourselves. So this will be blocking in the thread pool. This is a task we should put a thread pool, of course. So it is allowed to block and to do some work. And when it's done, you set the value of this stuff, and by magic, all the features will go to the last. So the first task will say, OK, I'm done. And if you're bigger than the cutoff, then you want to create two new FIB tasks with n-1 or n-2, what you learn always in the perfect example. So then we create a continuation, and we should pack our result. And this stuff will be called when all these tasks will be done. This stuff. So we packed two FIB tasks, so we're going to get a tuple of two futures. And then we just have to get them and set a value of result with this. And as if we should know, okay, this task is done. Who else is waiting for it? So we have one task, waiting, creating task, and the one down say, I'm done. The one up will say, are you both done? Yes, okay. And it goes like this to the first one, and it's finished. And to start it, you are in your post callback, and you make a return, don't forget the return, so that I know it's not void, which you want. And you has, I want the first continuation to start with the first flip task. Then we get to create task and more task and more task and more task. So the first thread we should go to start doing this, we create lots of tasks. And then the first thread of the thread pool will come, steal one job, and create more tasks and more tasks. Then the third one will come and steal from him or from the other one, and you get more and more. And at the end, very fast, you have all your thread pool, all your threads filled with Fibonacci tasks. Then you can have a second pool coming and stealing from it, etc., etc., etc. And when all are done, you get your callback with a feature long. Okay? But really, it's for the extreme cases. Okay, as I was at it, because now I'm blocked in something with features, I can offer you more feature stuff. You can say, if I move, I have not Fibonacci task because it's viadic, but you can have also a vector of features, and then you will get not a tuple, but you will get a vector of features. At least it should be long, but okay, good. Okay, this case was feature in, so it's okay. Or you can move every feature alone, and then you get a tuple of future, as many as you have features here. So if you have a library which just mainly gives you a feature instead of giving you a callback, you take it, say, oh my God, it's ugly. You pack it in your continuation, say, sir, give me a callback when you're done. And then the continuation will be called when it's finished. So now we want more. We have continuations. Okay, we have callbacks. Okay. The problem is, if you buy an Core i7 PC, you will pay, I counted, 100 euro for every core, about. But Intel doesn't want you to buy this. Intel would love you to buy dual Xeon, yes, for which you will pay 250 euro per core, for each core. Two and a half times. And it's not even, it doesn't have even the same clock frequency. You get to get for this 2.4 GHz instead of 3.3 or 4. Okay, I don't want to play with, I don't want to use dual core. I want to use two i7 for cheaper. Ah, yes, sounds good. Okay, so precondition, we'll get to play with networks. So the task has to be serializable, as defined by boost serialization, because I'm writing a boost library, I'm allowed to use just boost. So you have to make serialization. And the return value has to, of course, be serializable because it has to come back. And we create a new scheduler, which we use as a thread pool. It's a TCP scheduler. It has a queue. It has a queue for its work, and it has a worker pool. And what is a worker pool? It's a scheduler which we use to serialize, deserialize jobs. Because, I mean, if you have a big task, you don't want one thread to do it. You want to do it with a big pool of threads to serialize as deserialize as fast as you can. So we create a worker pool for all the serialization and deserialization job. We say our server will listen on localhost 12345 and wait for some client to come and steal jobs. Okay, so we do, like always, post callback and post to this pool, to this guy, some jobs. And wait, that account will come and take it. I will not use the client because of lack of time. We can do more. Here we gave all to one TCP scheduler, but we are not doing any job ourselves. We would also want to help. Well, we have a composite. So we create a composite, and we should put the server pool which we had, a worker pool, and that's it. And then, which can be the same one as the one which does the serialization, deserialization job. And we start. So this one will steal from this one. So this one will start executing some jobs, and then this one will come and steal from him. But only if a client connects to say, I would like a job. So we start executing, we start using all our cores. The next machine will come, with a client will come and say, hey, I would like to steal you something. This guy will steal from this guy, if he can. It will go to the client, which executes the job and gives a callback. So if you have a parallel Fibonacci, it's becoming interesting. You start touching the first Fibonacci, you get two tasks, and each time makes two, so you have a huge number of tasks. Then the client comes, picks one, and gets also many, many tasks. Then the third client comes, takes more, and gets more tasks. So I have a limited number of supply of PCs, so I made it up to six. It was quite fast with six, but then I didn't have any more PCs free.
Can you quantify quite fast?
It was maybe 10% slower than if I did it with cores locally. I'm sure I can do better. Okay, if you have a, let's make a simple client. I want to show you the full client code because really I'm getting short in time. So we have, we want some client to steal some jobs. So we have a new name for this, a new asynchronous of your proxy, which says, I'm going to steal from this server. Every 20 milliseconds, I will try to see some jobs. Or when my queue is under 5 elements, or whatever you want. So it needs an SEO scheduler for the communication. It's this one. It's great, we also have one. It needs a pool. This for the to execute the job, of course, because if you have a client, you want it to go with all the cores you can find. And you have the server, and then some executor function telling how to deserialize, because this you have to tell me. So it's a bit ugly, but I will have, anyway, I have no time to show it, so such a bad luck. So, okay, but the documentation has lots of examples of how to do it. I will just show that it's possible. Now, you have a client. Client steals some jobs. But well, maybe someone can steal from the client too. How do we do this? We want a client which can be stolen jobs from. It sounds, we need a composite, right? Well, we have a composite. Okay, so this is our client pool, our which executes the jobs, and we give it a TCP server scheduler, the one we saw before, another one, and put them in the composite so that if a client connects to the server part of this first client, it will steal jobs from the pool which the servant executes. So we have our Fibonacci, boom, 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 boom. Client comes, takes a job, boom, 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 boom. The second one is coming, go to the server part, say, steal job. Oh, I could steal one. You get one, boom, 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 and then you get the result to the end, and then you're done. Which allows us to make some own parallel network. We have a server application having some Fibonacci tasks, and we have a normal client connected to it and stealing jobs. Okay, so far so good. Then we have a second client machine. This time it's a client and server. So the client steals jobs from him and starts executing them. Second machine comes and steals jobs. So for example, you have my laptop giving some jobs. I will steal yours to start executing some jobs. And at the end, behind yours, I will put my cell phone to start selling a bit of jobs, you know, because if yours is also full, maybe my phone can do something. So you can build your own network like this. And it scales pretty far, as far as I could do with what I have of PCs. Okay, so far so good. Do we have time for the parallel algorithms? I have 2 more minutes, it might take 5. Okay, so as I was at it, we want some parallel algorithms. So actually, it's more of a toy. I wrote just 2, the for and the invoke. And for the rest, I found some incredibly talented 15-year-old guy who will say to write all the other ones. So it's not so, it must be so hard, but okay, it's really good. So all this, they are so far continuation based. I will plan the version with callbacks because I will notice that's a bit faster. They are of course not blocking. We don't block. It's not the pile for of, and the pile invoke of the TBB. It's not blocking one. No way. It's distributable, of course, because the jobs which I create internally are also serializable. So if yours are serializable, then you will get distributable. And they work with iterators, but I'm not very happy about it, or with ranges or continuations. I will explain you what it means. So an example, post callback. You will have seen very often post callback this one today. This I should not do, but I do it because I use the iterator version. If I use the iterator version, so parallel for with begin end, you have to be sure that they stay valid to the end of the call. That's why I say I don't advise you this one. So we have a parallel for, which will const cast because I'm mean, and I'm going to modify the vector also. And you get a future void because it's in place modification when it's finished. You give a cutoff, meaning if my array has 10,000, I will be divided in packets of 1,500. And then they will be put in the pool and they'll start executing. This is not blocking, and when it's finished, this will be called. Okay? Such face, I'm explaining something really bad, right? It's just a normal task. It's a simple task. We'll be telling you, make a parallel for, and when you're done, call this. It's just this, actually. You just give a cutoff, because you decide when you want, or which size you want your packets to have, and that's it. We have a second version. This time, it's much better. We use the move lambda. Oh God, I waited so long for that one. Thank you, God, that I finally have it. So now, There's just one possible way to move something to a task. It's move. By value, it's risky. By pointers, it's very bad, and by reference also. Why by move is risky? Because if you move something by value, shape under by value, for example, onto an object which has a boost signal, you're going to have some fun.
What happens if you have an access during the move?
An access during the move. It's not this. This is the task. I create the task. It's not posted yet. It's getting created, right? So obviously, I don't have an access. It's my data. I'm in single thread.
Yeah, but you're
going to
have lots of problems.
There is no problem. All is okay. There is no race condition. All right. These are not the duress you're looking for.
As long as you're not threading outside of using this library, you
yes.
do not have a problem.
Your problem is only if you start building some races in my back. Then I will not help you. This lambda is created before it's posted. So when you create the lambda, you already move. But of course, if you have race condition before, I cannot help you. So then we make, it's time we have a return, and then we move, which means, dear asynchronous, I would like you to take ownership of this container and to give it back when you're done. This time we get it back. It's moved in the task, changed in parallel, and moved back to the future, and then you can get it, and you have it. Now it's safe. As long as it takes care of it, you don't have to take care of it, all is okay, all is going to be good.
Size of the data when you post the callback?
No.
What partition is that?
You decide the partition.
That's
this is a cutoff when you want to catch your task. I don't want to attempt at finding the correct size for a task. I think this is something which just someone who is doing it knows. You have to try it and until you find it's good. Maybe some race have some cool algorithm which I will have to have, but I don't have a solution yet.
Depending, on the CPU, if you do things properly, don't make it smaller than 100 microseconds. And
yes, but I do not know, as a library implementer, how long is the task going to last.
The issue is
someone has to make some profiling before. So the idea is, of course, if it's under a certain size, you should not parallelize. Yes, it's true. So someone has to check how long it takes and then guess what is the correct size. Because unless I will have to execute the task myself, know how long it takes, and then try to guess it myself. I would prefer not to do it. Okay, so we can do even worse. A parallel for gives you a continuation, meaning something which is going to be arranged later. So you have a version which takes a range itself. This I love it. You have a parallel for of parallel for. We move the data in the first parallel for. We're going to modify it. And this one will only be called after the first one is finished. So when this one is finished, we're going to remodify it in the second parallel for. And we're going to get it back. It doesn't work just with parallel for. It works with all the other ones. You can make a parallel for, of parallel reduce, of parallel invoke, of whatever you want. I don't care. Okay, so this one goes in parallel, then stops, and then this one goes in parallel second time. I'm above time. I could show you parallel P, but only if really it's a voluntary basis wants to stay. Okay, nobody wants to go, so it's a good sign. So we have a formal which has all this. I stole it from Intel because, you know, as I mean, I steal their stuff and I try to make it better because it's much more fun. To be honest, maybe, but I don't care too much because it's the example which I steal. It's probably not the best way also to calculate Fibonacci this way. And in case you don't know, the Fibonacci was probably very bad also. It's a much better formula for this.
It's representative of a certain class of problems.
So this will give us 1/4 of P. So we want a sum from 0 to whatever we want. And for every element, we want to apply this. Well, actually, it's an embarrassing parallel problem. We have a P, so it's for one element, we're going to apply, for every element, we're going to apply this stuff. So we have our post callback, the last time you will see today. We get the result, and then what do we do? Let's start from right to left, because otherwise it's too bad. This is a fake range, because we don't want to create a range of 1 billion elements to be able to apply them. It's something which is lazily going to create a number so we can apply the formula on it. And which means from 0 to this number, we're going to apply this stuff. And then, what is it? It's a sum. A sum is a parallel reduce with a lambda making plus, right? It's a reduce. So, we have a reduce on this range. I wish we will go to plus. So this is the size of our cutoff. So we are pi reduce. So we're going to get from this, the sum, we're going to get 1/4 of p. In the Intel documentation, they take the double multiplied by 4. Or could do the same also. But well, it's not fun enough. We create some invoke, which works in the continuation, so means the result of this stuff, and going to make to multiply by 4. So what we get here is really p. It's hard, I killed everybody right now, right? Okay. And all this, of course, is asynchronous, doesn't block, doesn't do anything, and you get to go back when it's done, if you're still alive, or maybe it will be started if you're not alive, and whatever. So, modulo bugs, you should have no race condition, no deadlock, and no blocking. Questions? It's my last slide, I really finished this time, I promise. Oh yes, it was the last time. We had to find it in GitHub because it's not yet in Boost. I didn't offer it to review for review yet.
Have you made any performance figures? You know, how many tasks can you push into the different kinds of schedulers?
And yes.
Made any comparison between
yes.
other alternatives, for example, Microsoft's PPL,
yeah, I made some tests. So the question is if I made some performance tests. So I made some tests first for myself, meaning if we have a log3q, okay, you give a log3q a size. If you get it, if you make it too big, you're going to degrade the performance of log3. So this is the first one. You have to estimate what how big you want your q. So this is the first one, your performance yourself. Now I didn't compare to Microsoft, I compared to TBB. I compared to Parallel 4 with callbacks. I didn't write the numbers yet, so I did, that's why it's not in the documentation. So I compared with Parallel 4, P and Fibonacci. The difference was, it's very small. And Parallel 4 asynchronous was faster. On Fibonacci it was about the same. And on P it was slightly slower when I do it with continuations, so something like 2% slower. And 2% faster when I did it with callbacks. It's very close. But I didn't try on a huge benchmark of all possible COVID configurations and stuff. This is what I do need to do next. I will need to do it for the review anyway.
There was a presentation on libcppa. Do you see any difference between what you are doing and libcppa? Hmm.
So if I see a difference with libcppa, the problem is I was not in the talk, so I cannot give an opinion on this. I need to look at the slides. I cannot answer this question.
I can comment as to that. LibcPA is an actor-based approach. This is a bit different in nature. It's closer to what Hartman and I are working on, which is specifically not actor-based. It's a little hard to quantify, but it's definitely very distinct in terms of how it's approaching asynchrony.
Actually, to be honest, I saw the problem for me. I wanted something not blocking, wish I could parallelize as much as I could find cores, and to prevent, because I work in a big team, and not everybody knows good how to handle threads, I wanted to hide threads from them. So if you're in the same case, you can make use of it. If you're happy with what you have, then it's okay.
What happens or how to handle exceptions which are thrown inside of a job?
You get them there. If the job throws, you get it here. That's why I have a future. I did the whole stuff with just for this, actually, to have exceptions. I used my future only as transport system of values and exceptions. It's the only reason for which I use futures, actually. I don't need them. I don't need to get to block them.
So you, when you have a remote scheduler, you transfer the state of the exception somehow? Or
yes, a transfer exception. If it's sizable, it's, you get it also.
So it's not very trivial to serialization mechanism with some other custom serialization?
As I said, at the moment, so the question is if I want to, if I can replace the serialization with other systems, it is possible. It is not completely easy because I'm supposed to work with boost serialization, so I cannot change. You can choose any archive type you want. What you cannot choose is a way of serialize. So you need either the serialize function or the load and save and the split like boost serialization. So for the moment, I have just this one because I'm not allowed to use anything else.
It's very hard to find other serialization options, especially if you're doing anything with where you want to be able to serialize derived classes. We've been trying for 5 years to find a serialization option that has support that's anything resembling what food serialization has. And we've not been able to find anything that's even remotely feasible.
Yeah, I was thinking about compatibility with other existing systems or messages.
We could do this. If you find another one, we'll be happy to support it also, if it's a popular one. For the moment, I don't do my own serialization because I have no wish of world domination. So I just take what is there. I use Future because it's there. I use Serialization because it's there. I use SEO because it's here. I use Qt because it's there. And then there's not a lot of putting extensions. I use all the stuff which I find in Boost. So I rewrite only what I do not find. That's why serialization is there. Okay, I take it. But if someone has wished for something new, why not? Great, thank you very much.